Hey everybody, I'm pleased to introduce Sara Negri, who will speak on topological generalizations of possible worlds, semantics, and their proof systems. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes. I will talk about proof systems for non-normal model logics. And as you all know, the history of proof theory for modal logic is a rather recent enterprise because modal logic was essentially studied axiomatically. And it took much longer than for intuitionistic or classical logic to develop analytic proof systems. And the first attempts were for very limited systems of modal logic. And the situation in the study of modal logic changed with the introduction of a general semantics, the possible world semantics. And in a way, this approach took over. On the proof theoretic side, meaning development of analytic proof systems, there were two main trends. And one, now I mentioned this, I did this because this has been the talk on hypersequence. One trend consisted in extending the structure of sequence with extra things. And display calculus, hypersequence, nested sequence, and so on. The other trend that started in the 90s with some anticipation consisted in maintaining the structure simple, very simple structure of sequence, and adding other elements in the form of variables, which stand for the semantic elements. With the idea from possible world semantics. And very recently there have also been some comparisons between these two systems. And there is a paper, and I'm not going to talk about this, and because it would take too much time, that establishes a translation between the labeled approach and the nested sequence approach for the logic of counterfactuals. It will be presented at the Advances in Modal Logic. Here I will focus on labeled systems, and more specifically, the labeled approach, which deals on contraction-free sequence calculi, starting from my old paper of 2005. Actually, there has been a decisive extension of that approach because in joint work with Roy Dickoff, we have been able to prove that one can actually represent any first order condition on a class of frames. So it works in a very, very general way for possible world semantics, crippled semantics. However, possible world semantics is what to say normal normative. It imposes normality. And what is normality? It has inbuilt validity of the rule of necessitation and validity of axiom K. So does it? Validity of axiom, rule of necessitation, axiom K. And why we're not happy with that? People study modal logic from a lot of different fields. And one is the field also of formal epistemology, we heard it yesterday. And in formal epistemology, the modality has a reading of knowledge, but not knowledge of an ideal agent, but of a true agent, who is not omniscient, because those two properties, when box is the modality of knowledge, impose omniscience. So the agent knows every theorem, the agent knows every logical consequence of what she knows. And also some interpretation in game theory, or where the modality is interpreted as an operator of high probability, take to the rejection of this property, if you read that this as high probability. Also, the base of modal logic is inadequate when one wants to treat the conditional beyond the material implication or straight implication. And in fact, David Lewis, who wrote about counterfactuals, was one of the first who proposed in practice a generalization of possible world semantics. So this neighborhood semantics started in the late 60s, early 70s, and you see those people there who gave early contributions. More recently, it has been studied in the semantics of belief and vision with group models. And very, very recently, it has had a new renaissance, and it is becoming very, very popular. I recall what is neighbor semantics. So, in neighbor semantics, we start with the structure of neighbor frame, which is a set of possible words, and a neighbor function. A neighbor function is a function that associates to every word a set of subsets of the word. So, the main idea is that the words in the neighborhood are the substitute of the accessibility relation, and indeed the interpretation of the modality is that box A is forced at word X if there is some neighborhood of X which is equi-extensional with extension of A. And there can be different intuitions on this semantics. For conditionals, there is the idea of a similarity, degrees of similarity with the actual world. And there is a very precise link between neighborhood semantics and possible world semantics. And in fact, possible world semantics is a generalization because if we have a relational frame, we can define a neighborhood frame by taking as neighborhood all the supersets of the sets of words accessible from X, the out of X. And conversely, if we have a neighborhood frame, we can define a relational frame by taking the accessibility relation Y is accessible from X if Y belongs to the intersection of all the neighborhoods of X. And then we have that the neighborhood frame is augmented, this is a definition, if it is closed under supersets, and for every X, the neighborhoods of X contain the intersection, so the intersection of all the neighborhoods of X is a neighborhood of X. And maybe you have noticed something familiar here. And in fact, the precise link is between, there has been a switch, no speakers. the link is between relational frames and the augmented neighborhood frames. So they are the same thing, they validate the same formulas. So this correspondence is actually non-correspondence among people who do topology and formal topology, because it's just a form of the Alexandrov correspondence. Alexandrov topological spaces are those that correspond to pre-order. And in fact, there has been also recently a paper that suggests studying Alexandrov topology for conditional. But one indeed does not need the full strength of the topology, since it is enough to have the structure of neighborhood frames without closure on the intersection, without arbitrary union. So, these would be definitions of the forcing relation for various modalities or conditionals. So for non-normal modalities, we have already seen what it is, and for the conditional of a preferential conditional logic, this is in a way rewriting of the condition given by Lewis, and also, so this CDL is conditional logistic logic, so the logic of conditional belief. So this is the paper that appeared the other day in the review of symbolic logic. And I have to proceed very fast. So I will concentrate on non-normal modal logics, the classical cube of non-normal modal logics, which are the extensions of system E. Oops. Yeah, press the wrong button. So this is logic E. The box is closed under logical equivalence, and then this closed under this is N, closure under necessitation. This is the monotonic systems, and this axiom C. And it gives this this cube of modal systems by taking all the possible combinations of those axioms or groups. So how do we define a sequence calculus? So the first step is to look at the condition for the modality. So that it's a meaning-conferring explanation, and we can, following a general methodology, translate it into rules. But it's not as simple as for standard modal logic, because write the condition. So this is the this is the condition, and it is there exists a neighborhood of X such that for all elements in the neighborhood they force A, and for every X that forces A, X is in the neighborhood. So we have a bad nesting of formulas which is cannot be translated directly into rules. So the first step is to add new primitives, and these new primitives are what I call local forcing relations. So the universal forcing neighborhood universally forces a formula A, so it just takes this first part. And then there is this covering relation for the opposite, for the second part. And well, and then we can give rules, the rules for the two forcing conditions, and the rules for the triangle, and the rules for the modality. So if you read these rules, these correspond exactly to for all x in A, this is a comma. It's not a misprint, now it looks it's indeed a comma. For all x in A, x forces A. Now to save space, the forcing condition at the formal level is written with a column. And so this is the left rule, and this is the rule for the modality. Look at the rule for box. This is best read root first, so it means that if X forces box A, if not if there exists a neighborhood of A, so A in X, such that it forces universally A, and we have the covering. This A is fresh, so this variable condition replaces the quantifier in the meaning explanation. And the dual rule for the right rule. So then one can treat the extensions, which can be represented either by the rules that I've shown before or by these axioms. And one can find the rules of the calculus to represent these extensions, either through non-correspondences or just using the calculus like in a bootstrap way. The calculus finds its own rules in a way, by abduction, by proof search in the basic system. And in this basic system, we find just by proof search for these axioms, so we just write the sequence x colon this formula, and we apply the rule root first, and we see that the only way to find the derivation is to have a rule of this form. So it's the rule of monotonicity that corresponds to the frame property of being supplemented, so closure under supersets. In a similar way, one finds the rule for system C, and the rule corresponds to closure under intersection. Intersection of two neighborhoods is a neighborhood, and for system N, contains the unit, so that the set of possible rules is a neighborhood of X. Then one is a rule of formal inclusion as well, to add to this rules, which is as one would expect. So this is a non-result, completeness of the logic of the model cube with respect to neighbor semantics. Cellas proved it by canonical models, and with this approach it can be proved directly by Takeuchi style completeness proof. For monotonic systems, one can simplify the rules, and indeed one finds a phenomenon which is common to other things in labor calculi. There are some the frame conditions that cannot be expressed as first order conditions, like Noetherianity. So for finding calculi for probability logic or Gregor logic or Gödel-Leib, one embeds Noetherianity into a modification of the forcing condition. And here we have a similar thing, just easier, in the sense that for monotonic neighborhoods, one can modify the forcing condition and then instead of this forcing condition, the forcing condition that just omits the second part. And one obtains these rules, so simply the part of the rules that does not mention the covering, and one obtains in this way a complete system for monotonic logic without having to add the rule of monotonicity. And then one can prove these calculi are made and they are just to have all the good structural properties. Of course, there must be some additions to the general theory, but these are all the results that can be proved. For non-monotonic systems, it would be good. So this is based on this joint work with Delmonte and Olivetti. Let's go back to the semantic clause for box. So observe that in the rules we had this the triangle relation, and the feature of taking rules where the semantic part also appears on the right hand side of sequence, and we wouldn't like to have that because you get a cleaner system by adding all the semantic elements on the left hand side. But look at the clause, so this is the clause we had before for the forcing of the box, this can be rewritten by, in this second part, by contraposition. It is equivalent to saying that if X is in the complement of the neighborhood alpha, then X does not force alpha, or X forces the negation of alpha. The clause would be that there is a couple, a pair, alpha beta, such that alpha forces universally A and beta forces universally the negation of A. Beta forces universally the negation of A is the same as it's not the case that beta forces existence. So, there is no element in beta that forces A. And this means that that part can be switched from one side to the other of sequence. In particular, we don't need to add the new triangle operator. Beta can be interpreted in a sense that has to be made precise as the complement of the neighborhood alpha. So here the intuition is that we have evidence for A if we have both positive evidence and negative evidence, lack of evidence for the negation of A. One can think of some examples, for example, in medical diagnostics, where one wants to exclude some causes. Or you can think about that, and there are good examples. So this takes us from requirements from proof systems. So first we went from the semantics to proof systems, but now we move in the other direction. We go from structural requirements on proof systems to a new generalized semantics, which we call a bi-neighborhood model. So bi-neighborhood model is just like a neighborhood model, but now we have pairs of subsets of W, of the set of possible words. And the only requirement is that their intersection is empty. A bi-neighborhood model is an N model if the set of possible and the empty set belongs to this neighborhood, is a C model if it is closed under intersection on the first component, union on the second, and M model if the second component is empty set. And then the forcing relation, which is what comes from the rewrite that we had on the rules, is this one. So W forces in this neighborhood semantics box A if there is some bi-neighborhood alpha beta where the first component alpha forces universally A and the second forces universally not A. So let's see what... So first thing is that we have a completeness soundness theorem and completeness. Completeness can be obtained indirectly because neighborhood models are a special case of bi-neighborhood models, but it can also be obtained directly by the canonical models. And the canonical models are quite unsurprisingly obtained by taking as sets of possible words maximal consistent sets of formulas. The valuation is the usual valuation, and then the canonical neighborhoods are supersets. They are pairs where the first component is a superset of A, the second supersets among maximal consistent sets of not A, where box A is contained in X, where X is a maximal consistent set of formula. And then one can prove the truth lemma and can prove that this indeed gives. Well, for the monotonic system, one has to add a supplementation construction. But yes, it works. But then one can find the calculus. I started 5 minutes later. So the calculus has words labels, word labels, and neighborhood labels. And then one can also have a structure, term structures on these labels that correspond to intersection and to the complementation. So we have this, the intersection is written by just position of the terms and complementation by an overline. The term tau represents the sets, the maximal neighborhood, and then there is the overline T. Then there are positive or negative complex terms, and one has the usual Boolean intuition that an overline of terms is interpreted, the complex term is interpreted as the union of the complements. And one does not have, does not really iterate this complementation because it comes from the rules of the calculus that it does not have to be repeated. So these terms are introduced in pairs in the positive and the negative part. And this is the language, so please, sorry for this polymorphic notation. Here there is a translation in the usual language. I might also have wanted a more compact notation. This is the polymorphic notation of this calculus, and it stands for, so this is the usual forcing, word X forces A. So this is the column where on the left we have a possible word, on the right a neighborhood term is X is in T, and here this is X in T bar. Then when we have a positive term, this stands for the universal forcing, and when we have a negative term, it stands for the existential forcing. And this is just, this says that T is the neighborhood of X. And this is the calculus, which is now completely justified on the basis of this consideration. So these are the rules that we have already seen for the universal forcing. These are the rules for the existential forcing that correspond to the fact that existential forcing means there exists an element in the neighborhood that forces A. So you see in this left rule that it is really that one. And then we have the rules for the box, where this replaces the triangle, the covering relation, which was on the other side. And the rules for monotonic system, for example, this says that the complement of T is empty, so the second component is empty, and this is a rule for N, that this is a neighborhood of any X, the complement of tau is empty, and these are rules for intersection, which says that we can produce a neighborhood which is the intersection of two neighborhoods, and we can decompose it into parts, and both the positive and negative decomposition. And the calculus satisfies all the structural properties. Then one can give, so this is a long definition, I just say what it is. So it's an interpretation of the labels in the semantic structure, so it's a realization. And this just reflects our intuition on the language at the formal level. And so we have that the calculus is complete with respect to all these logics and sound. One can have an optimization of the rules for intersection by avoiding the repetition of complex terms and by decomposing all at once in their atomic components. And this produces a calculus. So now this number here, 3, we have the first calculus with the second calculus based on binary semantics, and this is an optimized calculus. One can also prove a cut elimination directly for this optimized calculus, but can show that the derivations in the second calculus can have a correspondence with those in this third calculus. So one can obtain an indirect syntactic completeness, but what is most important is that this calculus has a finite reproof search, and one obtains the finite model property as a result. So I skip this and summary. So this is the summary of what we have done. So we started from axiomatic systems for the classical modal logics, and we showed how to define proof systems based on neighborhood models. And this triangle has this, so this is the completeness theorem, and Kingstyle, this is the completeness theorem, direct completeness theorem, this is cut elimination. But then one can modify this calculi and obtain a new semantics, the semantics of binary models, and we still have all the three thick arrows. But then when we optimize these calculi, we obtain a third calculus, which, as often happens in proof theory, one loses something here, and there is not any more direct cut elimination, only through equivalence with other calculus. And but by the method of subtraction to search, one obtains a decision procedure and the finite model property. So we complete the picture in this way, and this is really fun. Yes, and I think I finished, and some references.
Thank you very much. Is there a question? Maybe one question?
Yeah.
It seems it has interpolation in that extended language.
So I haven't worked with interpolation.
Because most of them will have no interpolation, but in this slightly extended, it's very right.
So I cannot tell. I know that some people have worked and used the label calculi for proving interpolation.
I think there's a paper by Roman interpolation to the label calculi for non-modal logics.
Yes.
And probably this method can be adapted to your case, and basically it can have a calculation for all logics which are defined by theory universe. Because when you have geometric rules, things get a little bit messy.
Okay, I'm sorry for that.
Yeah.
One more question, maybe? Okay, thank you very much.